Thank you, everybody, for coming to our appellate law section meeting. We have a very special treat for you today. We've got our Ninth Circuit judges, one judge sitting by designation from West Virginia. But before I introduce all of them, I just have several obligatory announcements. And then I'm going to ask our bar president, Mr. Barone, to come up and give an announcement having to do with our human trafficking initiative. Is he here? I don't know that I see him, but if he walks in the room, you'll know because I'll tap him to come up for that announcement. Just please make sure your cell phone is silenced. Please complete the evaluation forms at the end of the meeting and place them in the collection box. Upon arrival, attendees must sign in on the registration sheet by 12:45 p.m. They do pull those sheets at 12:45, and they will not let you sign in after that, which means you don't get your CLE credit. Do you want me to wear it? Okay. Over here? Okay. This is kind of a fancy meeting we normally have because we don't really have all these mics. And today we're having live streaming. So I want to welcome everybody who is live streaming today. And the video will also be made available on the Ninth Circuit's website, courtesy of the Ninth Circuit IT Department. And special thanks to MC Singela for her role in putting all of that together for us. So without further ado, before I introduce our panel speakers, there are several attendees that I'd like to recognize. We've got MC Singela over here, and MC, you're one of the trustees, aren't you, for the Orange County Board? One of the board of directors, and we've got Autumn Spaeth, who's joining us, and she's also a director. And who else am I missing? Michael Gregg, thanks for coming. And we've got former bar president over here. In the back, please introduce yourself. Ed Connor. Anyone else that I'm missing? Okay. Well, let me go ahead and introduce our panel. And we'll start straight up with the questions, I think. Over to my right is Judge Faber. He's from the Western District of Virginia. He's sitting by designation on the Ninth Circuit this week. He has sat by designation on the Ninth Circuit before, and he also sits by designation on the Fourth Circuit. We have Judge Connie Callahan, who is certainly not a stranger to the Orange County Bar Association. She has graced us before with her presentations, and we are very grateful to all of our panelists today for coming down. We have Judge Sandra Okuda from the Ninth Circuit. She's chambered in Pasadena. She previously clerked for Judge Alex Kaczynski, and then clerked for Justice Sandra Day O'Connor, and now sits with her former boss, Judge Kaczynski, on the Ninth Circuit as a circuit judge. So thank you, and a warm welcome, please, to our panel members. So let me start with you. You are a visiting judge this week for the Ninth Circuit. How does your experience on the two circuit courts vary, on both the Fourth Circuit and the Ninth Circuit?
Well, I'm going to correct one small error you made. I'm from West Virginia, and that's very important to us.
I said Virginia?
We say West by God, Virginia. And I might add that I, being from kind of the country, I rode down here an hour and a half on your local highways with Sohan at the wheel, and my hair was brown when we left Pasadena. I think the practice differs significantly with regard to some small things, but not much with regard to big things. And I jotted down a few things. As a visiting judge, if you get invited to sit with the Fourth Circuit, You get a docket, a calendar, or cases set for oral argument, and you know that those are going to be your cases, and they're going to be argued. The staff lawyers in Richmond screen out the cases that are routinely decided without oral argument. So if you're a visiting judge, you get the briefs and a docket, and you know that you're going to have argument in those cases, as distinct from the Ninth Circuit, where you'll get a list of cases, and quite a few of them will be decided without oral argument. Fourth Circuit allows a good bit more time for argument. Typically, it's 30 minutes a side. you get four cases a day. If you sit the whole week, you're going to have 20 cases to deal with, four a day. Typically, the arguments last 30 minutes a side, and here I've found that they're shorter. There's very little back and forth among the judges on the panels once a case is circulated for decision. If there's an obvious error, like a bad citation or a word left out or something like that, you'll pick up the phone, call the authoring judge and tell him, or maybe have your clerk do it. But there's a much more rigorous process here in contact between the judges on the panel after the case is the opinion is prepared, and that probably tends to produce a better final product. And in the Fourth Circuit, the author of the opinion decides whether to publish it or not. It's not a joint decision very often by the judges among the panel. So there are judges who like to publish and publish most of what they write, and there are judges who don't publish much of anything, like me. I hardly ever publish anything. I think the published law is basically the province of the courts of appeals. So unless it's a really interesting or unique or cutting edge issue that there might be a circuit conflict or no published opinions at all on it, then I might publish. But some of my brother district judges publish most of what they write. It's just up to the judge in the Fourth Circuit. Those are little things. I don't know of any big differences.
Let me ask a follow-up question, Judge Faber. What contributions does a visiting judge make to a circuit panel, whether that's a district judge who's visiting or a circuit judge?
The main reason we're there is to help get the work done, and we get invited when caseloads get severe and they need help. I've done much more work at the district level out of my district than I have sitting with our Court of Appeals in the circuit, because we now have a full complement of appellate judges. But over the years, I've been on the bench 26 years, and over the years I've had cases in 7 of the 9 districts within the Fourth Circuit. And some of those assignments have lasted a long time. I agreed to go to the Eastern District of North Carolina a few years ago to do 2 cases, and 5 years later I left after I'd done 20 some. So you have to be careful what you volunteer for. I think probably the most significant contribution a district judge can make at the appellate court is to bring the perspective of a trial judge to the court, and hopefully that's helpful. I'm sure it's not always helpful, but those are probably 2 things that I could think of that are contributions.
Can I say something, Jimmy?
Please.
And I think that might be helpful for your audience, because Judge Faber and I are sitting together this week, and I'm presiding, and so we have 5 days of calendars. And he's exactly right. The Ninth Circuit could not do the work it does without having district judges that sit on assignment, both from our own circuit, our senior judges sitting on taking cases, some even take up to 100% caseload, and then those coming from the outside. We couldn't get the work done, and that is that we would like to be getting even more work done, because Congress never gives us more judgeships. So they are making a tremendous contribution. And I was telling Judge Faber earlier, like this week that I'm presiding over, there'll be 5 judges during the week. I'm sitting with Judge Owens, who's an active Ninth Circuit judge. I am Judge Ferris, who is a senior Ninth Circuit judge, Judge Faber, and then we have 1 other judge. And the only thing, for those of you that practice it, you have to know is that's a lot of, you know, it makes it harder for you to know every judge that you're sitting in front of. And I think every panel really is, every panel is different depending on the judges. And so I find it a little difficult presiding over a week of that many judges, if only because I always have to do the conference notes. I don't have anyone else that I can put them off on. But also, too, when we sit together, I've noticed that we kind of get a rhythm going, and we get how we all work together. And it's kind of a fits and starts when you have that many different judges coming in. Does it change the outcome? I believe that people that come do their very best to, they sit very conscientiously and contribute, and they're an equal vote to any of the active judges as far as that goes. But I see it as the presiding judge of that week. I have to really try to get a rhythm going that's more difficult than when I have three Ninth Circuit judges that I all know the whole week.
Well, let me ask this follow-up question before I turn to Judge Ikuda, because I think it's a question that's on the mind of many advocates, appellate advocates that appear before, not just the Ninth Circuit, but any circuit that has visiting judges. I mean, what is the quality of that vote that that visiting judge has? Meaning, is that judge a little more susceptible to agreement with the other two judges, assuming there is unanimity among the other two judges? Is that judge willing to speak up? And I'm sure this is more of a subjective question, but in your experience, have you seen those visiting judges being able to speak up and say, well, wait a second, I don't know that I agree with that approach, or I don't know that I agree with that law, or I think that I recommend that the case does go en banc. I know I don't get a vote, but on the petition for rehearing en banc, I do recommend that it goes en banc. See, I've never seen that happen, at least as an outside observer. So I wonder if maybe Judge Ikuda or Judge Callen or both could comment on their experiences with visiting judges and maybe assure us or reassure us or disabuse us of our notions of visiting judges. Because I often wonder if it's a little bit they're occupying a third seat, and I don't know that I see anything less than harmony that's provided by that visiting judge.
I sat with a delightful visiting judge, Judge Rustani from the International Court of Trade, and she was bored because all they do is judge about one federal statute. So she goes from circuit to circuit. Anyway, on our court, it wasn't a panel I was on, she dissented. It was called en banc based on her dissent. It didn't go en banc. A dissent from denial was written, and the Supreme Court took it up on a cert petition, and she ended up being vindicated. So yes, a visiting judge can have a huge impact.
Well, that's a great example.
I think, though, that it varies from visiting judge to visiting judge. I've had visiting judges say to me sometimes, well, I'm just sitting here on assignment and maybe seem a bit deferential starting. And I say, no, your vote counts the same as everyone else's, so don't go along to get along. Say, and so, but I think some think that way a little bit coming into it, but need to be encouraged. The other side, something that I see, district judges, some don't like sitting on assignment, and district judges are the kings of their own fiefdom. For me to get my way, I have to get at least one other vote. And so some district judges find it not as attractive to sit on assignment on an appellate court because they can't really do what they believe to do right without engaging in that the power of persuasion as far as that goes. And I think I really value the vote, but we do have... There are things that come about sometimes, for example, if something is going to be published in the Ninth Circuit and there's a likelihood that it could be called en banc, the visiting judge is not going to be there to defend. That's something that the rest of the panel has to defend. And so oftentimes, for example, as a presiding judge, if there's that type of case, you may assign it not to a district judge that's visiting or an out-of-circuit judge that's a senior judge precisely because you know that you're going to have to defend it to an en banc panel and you need to retain that control.
We don't think it's fair to the district judges to make them play all of our en banc games. So. We try to relieve them of that.
Probably a relief for them. Well, Judge Ikuda, I mentioned in my introductory remarks about you that you sit now on the same court which you once clerked for. You clerked for Judge Alex Kaczynski, and you are not alone. We have Judge Paul Watford, who's also a former clerk. to Judge Kaczynski and now one of your colleagues, one of your junior colleagues on the court. I can't help but draw the parallel between Justice Kennedy and now Justice Gorsuch. That comes to mind because it's the first time we've had a law clerk to a justice sit with the same justice that he or she clerked for. But it does make me wonder, because I remember when I was clerking too, I wondered this question. Judge Okuda was just coming on board when I was finishing my clerkship with Judge Callahan. And I think the question that everyone was asking, but no one asked, was, so what's she going to do? Is she going to always agree with Judge Kaczynski? Or is there going to be less unanimity with Judge Kaczynski, less agreement? And I think I've answered the question just studying your course and your opinions as you are so independent, independent in the sense that it seems to me like there's a healthy amount of disagreement with your former boss. But the question I want to ask you is, how does that relationship, that previous relationship, impact your current role as a circuit judge?
Well, I would certainly say that Judge Kaczynski was a fantastic role model when I was clerking for him. At least at that point, he was really the model of a judicial conservative, someone who took the law very seriously and followed it, even if in his own views, that was not the right path to go. And I believe that I certainly imbibed that aspect of judicial philosophy from him. But as a working judge, I don't think that relationship or former relationship has an impact beyond the fact that I'm independently trying to follow the law. At one point, this was back 6 or 7 years, I was on a special sitting with Judge Kaczynski and Justice O'Connor. She was sitting by designation, and we were all sitting on the bench, and I was like looking down and feeling that it was a little strange to be sitting with both my former bosses. But as soon as oral argument starts, you're just working. You're just asking questions. You're just trying to figure out what the right answer is. So I think at the end of the day, the training I got from both of my bosses was very important, but it doesn't have any determinative impact on how I would decide a case.
I have to say, I was witness to the first en banc where Judge Kaczynski was presiding and Judge Okuda was junior. And in the en banc, when after the junior person talks first and then you go up to the chief will talk last. And this was her debut, that where you come in for the, I guess I'm talking out of school, but I'm not, because I'm not saying what the case was. But she started talking about, there's no one that's more prepared than this woman. I mean, she's scary. And so she starts talking, and.
Let the record show you were referring to Judge Okuda.
Yes, and I will. And then Judge Kaczynski starts sort of questioning her, like she's a law clerk sitting there. And I don't think Judge Kaczynski has ever had a match in the same room in the same way. And I was so proud after to see the independence, because we wondered, you wonder coming in, will you be able to move out of it? Well, I had no doubt after the first time out. And it's wonderful.
You know, if there is time, I would like to ask you a question, Judge Okuda. And I'll move on to my next question right now. But you were an editor or a journalist out of law school for a martial arts magazine. And I'd like to learn a little bit more about that because, I read that about you, but I've never heard you talk about it. So if there's time at the end, Judge Callahan, let me move over to you. What most don't know about you, it's a story I learned when I just started clerking for you, was that you had interviewed with both the public defender's office and the DA's office, I believe in San Joaquin County, out of law school, and you were waiting to hear back from both of those offices, and the first that got back to you, if I have the story right, was the prosecutor's office, the DA's office, and that's the job you took, and that's the path that kind of set your way to the bench. But being a former prosecutor, how has that shaped your jurisprudence, both civil and criminal? And do you ever regret not taking that public defender job?
Well, I actually did work for the public defender in Sacramento County for my third year of law school and for a summer. So I was a little bit favoring that. But the first person, I had to take the first call. And I had said yes. And I think it turned out to be a better choice for me, but I really enjoyed both. And I would say my experience as a prosecutor, well, I tried 70 jury trials as a prosecutor. I lived in a courtroom for 10 years. And you have a lot of discretion as a prosecutor in deciding who to charge, you know, whether to reduce things, how you're going to, what sort of sentences you're going to recommend. And I think I did capital cases during that. And then when I was a Superior Court judge, I did capital cases. So I think in terms of criminal law, having done both sides of it, I'm very firmly committed to the fact that it's very important to have good lawyers on both sides, because for the truth to come out, I think that that's incredibly important. And whether you believe your client's innocent or not, or whether you believe in the system of justice, that people believe that they're entitled to the best representation, that's a really important part of things. But I think when it comes to criminal law, there's not a lot I haven't seen, and probably it's a harder area to fool me in. For those of you that don't practice in that area, that, you know, I can pretty much get to the point there. I know what people are arguing about. I know what happens in trials. And so I think I'm really savvy in that area. But where I notice how it's played out a little bit as a judge, interestingly, a lot of times, I mean, every day you go to court, there's mistakes. Anyone that's done jury trials knows that about every 2 minutes someone makes a mistake. But most of those mistakes are harmless error. But when we're reversing things, we have to assess if an error is prejudicial. I think, in my view, and this is only my view, of course we're not very introspective about ourselves, I think I have a super good handle on what prejudicial error is, because I did so many jury trials myself. And then as a judge, I heard so many trials. I see how jurors think. What are the type of things that bother them? What are the type of things that make a difference if an error is prejudicial? So I feel very confident in my assessment of prejudicial error in trials, both civil and criminal. And I think sometimes people would be surprised. I don't always agree with my panelists that sometimes I might sit with someone that spent their career as a law professor and never saw the inside of a courtroom. And sometimes I may think something's prejudicial that they don't, and vice versa. And I think that experience of spending that much time in a courtroom in all of those aspects I'm pretty confident in that area, and I'm pretty confident that I'm right. How's that? So if, you know, I get that part of it.
Judge Faber, speaking of prosecutors, you were the United States Attorney for the Southern District of West Virginia prior to taking the bench. How would you say that your prosecutorial experience, your career, has impacted your role as an Article III judge, and maybe more specifically as a designated judge sitting on the circuit?
Well, hopefully it's made me a better judge, but that depends on the point of view. I was reading one of those reviews of judges online where people put in anonymous comments, and one of the comments about me was, former U.S. attorney still acts like one. That obviously came from a criminal defense lawyer. But I agree with Judge Hallinan. I think your experience as a prosecutor helps you to have an instinct of what is at the core of a case and what might be prejudicial and what might not be. And we all strive to make sure that the criminal defendants get a fair trial. And I hope that my prosecutorial experience helps me to identify things that would keep a criminal defendant from getting a fair trial. Of course, the government's entitled to a fair trial, too. That's about the best answer I can give
you. Do you think it makes you really concerned about factual innocence, too? Because that was a job that you did. And I think people don't realize that about prosecutors, what kind of concern they have about factual innocence. And those are the factual innocence and due process hit us hard.
Yeah, those are, you make a lot of hard decisions. My successor as U.S. attorney, when he was sworn in, said that he thought that this would be a great job when he took it, because he'd walk into my office and knock on the door, and I'd say, come in, and he said David would be standing there looking out the window, and I thought, this is a real good job if all you have to do is stand there and look out the window. And he said, now I'm United States Attorney, and I spend a lot of time looking out the window. Because you're thinking about those hard decisions you have. And you have so much discretion as a prosecutor. And one little step can ruin somebody's life or career. And you need to be constantly conscious of that, I think, to do a good job. You got to decline on a lot of cases where, not a lot, but you have to decline on cases where investigators are pushing you to make a decision that just doesn't feel quite right, and you have to have the courage to say no in those circumstances.
If we could just pivot over to federal appellate advocacy, I'd like to get into some of the building blocks, the do's and don'ts that make our job what it is. And let's begin with legal precedent, the role of legal precedent, mandatory versus persuasive authority. Last time when Judge Callahan visited us, we talked about how in the California state courts, appellate court decisions are not binding on other appellate courts. We're talking about the California Court of Appeal, even within the same district and that same division. In contrast, a decision by a panel in the Ninth Circuit is binding in all future cases in the circuit, at least in theory. I had to add that part for Judge Acuda. She was kind of holding it back. This difference may cause some California state court practitioners to get confused when handling an appeal in the Ninth Circuit. Do you see this mistake made in briefs? And are there any other situations where attorneys commonly confuse mandatory and persuasive authority?
I see in the briefs the lawyers are just throwing at us anything they have at hand. We see unpublished federal cases. We see district court cases from Kentucky. We see state court cases. We see lots of unpublished state court cases. I think that there is not much focus on what is actually binding on us. Every once in a while, we'll see something pretty obvious, like a brief that's urging us to overrule a precedent of our court without any acknowledgement that we actually can't do that, or at least in theory, can't do that. So I don't know. I'd actually be interested in hearing from the advocates about why you do that.
Turning the tables.
I've seen a few people that haven't known, and they kind of get the deer in the headlights look, like, oh, I didn't realize that. So I think that is really important. So don't ask us to do something that we can't do. I think all of us would agree that it's much more helpful to me if you're arguing something persuasively, or you recognize that something isn't binding, we're going to figure all that out. Just argue it that way and, you know, put your issue forth in a truthful way. Or I even say sometimes when I look at things that, you know, ask yourself, would Paul Clement or would Seth Waxman do that? And if they wouldn't, I'm sort of picking two former solicitor generals, then why? I mean, these are really successful people. Why would you do that? They're pretty straight shooting with the court, and they narrow the issues, and they make it really plain where the wiggle room is, and they argue within the wiggle room.
Well, what advice do you have to appellate advocates when they're writing their briefs, where they realize that, gosh, this authority is binding on the Ninth Circuit, assuming it's Ninth Circuit authority, and you know, the brave thing to do is to say, gosh, I lose under this, but it's wrong. It's just, the precedent is wrong. It was wrong back in 1960, and it's wrong today. Or maybe it wasn't wrong in 1960, it's just wrong today. And making that en banc call, if you will, making that invitation for en banc review at the outset, even in the opening brief. Have you seen that? If you haven't, what advice do you have to advocates who are entertaining such bravery?
I don't think it generally doesn't go anywhere, but there's no harm in raising it. I've found it's very rare, at least in my experience, maybe it's changing now, for a panel to make a sua sponte en banc call. So in other words, they've looked at the case before them and say we would have to follow the precedent and the precedent is wrong, and then asking our colleagues to vote on taking that case en banc to overrule the precedent. Now, I have seen a few of those calls, but it's very rare. Normally what
are they successful? Sorry to interrupt, but are they successful?
Frequently they are, when it does happen. There is a cultural, the culture of the Ninth Circuit is when a panel makes a sua sponte en banc call to generally go along with it. That may change, though, if the purpose of it is to overrule precedent rather than to resolve a intra-circuit conflict, which is usually why a sua sponte en banc call is made.
But you should never give up as an advocate in front of the Ninth Circuit, just because I would say, and most of you that if you practice in front of the Ninth Circuit have noticed that not all of the judges decide cases with the exact same approach. So that being said, you should, you know, read what the judges have written and see where you think that, that there has to be two votes. And I've written dissents where the Supreme Court has ultimately said that I was right, but a lot of these cases don't ultimately get to the Supreme Court. So if you really, you're an advocate, you gotta take your shot. So if you really feel that you have a panel that would be sympathetic, argue the law, but also argue what you want. I mean, you should never, I don't like to lose. I would never, there'd be a lot of things that I think are perfectly fine within your advocacy if you win.
We certainly get our share of distinctions made, both in the briefs and ultimately in the opinion, where of the nature of, well, the defendant in the precedent had tennis shoes, whereas the defendant here was wearing boots, and therefore,
this case does not apply.
Yeah. So Judge Callahan is right. You can always go for a distinction or for some argument as to why you win.
Well, there's a greater probability that you can hide contraband in boots.
There you go.
Jurisdictional issues. Moving on to everyone's favorite subject, actually mine. Subject matter jurisdiction. District and appellate courts, we know, must have jurisdiction. And appellate courts, the Ninth Circuit reviews its own jurisdiction independently to see at that stage if there is jurisdiction and justiciability. What are some examples of when you've seen a jurisdictional issue overlooked by the parties? And in particular, what are some of the less obvious situations where there is a jurisdictional issue?
This is one of my pet peeves, so Judge Callahan will have to let me go first. I've even written speeches, given speeches about this. Courts, the Ninth Circuit is no exception, but courts love to have jurisdiction because that's a source of power and authority. And so we have a lot of cases that push the boundaries of this. And I have written so many dissents. We have cases where there was no diversity jurisdiction, where there was no federal question jurisdiction. And you ask the parties where it's moot. Judge Callahan and I were just recently on a case where we asked the appellant, if we decide in your favor, what result will that have? What effect will that have? And he said, none. And so it is very common for the parties to come before the court where there's no jurisdiction, where both sides want the case to be decided, and so they haven't argued it, and they'll both argue that the court does have jurisdiction. And frequently the court will decide it does. Anyway, that's my hobby horse. I'll let Judge Callahan take over.
Well, no, I think that's exactly right. And I was going to say that sometimes parties fail to address events that have occurred subsequent to when even a court may have had jurisdiction on a mootness issue, and that we have to subsequently request them to do that. And I think depending on the judges that you have, I think Judge Ikuda and I probably train our law clerks that the first thing that they look at is, do we have jurisdiction? And that's our starting point. And if we don't, we feel like we have plenty of work to do. And I also think that we're firmly entrenched in the Constitution and the branches of government, and we feel very strongly about not coloring outside the lines. And so even though something can be very tempting and it seems that it should be answered, it ultimately does much more damage by coloring outside the lines for in one instance, and then you blurred the lines of jurisdiction. So I think it's we feel very similarly on this point.
Well, one memory I have, and it was fairly frequent, when you would get an appeal and it involved a diversity jurisdiction subject matter case, and the one of the parties, or more than one, was an LLP or an LLC or some association. And post the Supreme Court's decision in Grupo Dataflux, courts had to take a more examining or scrutinizing role in looking to see where the members and the partners are actually domiciled for purposes of diversity jurisdiction. And where you have 50 members, one in each state, let's say, I mean, diversity jurisdiction is pierced. There is no diversity jurisdiction. And I know that right leading up to oral argument, we would get the bench memos from other chambers, and that's when we would start to look and see, you know, if there's jurisdiction on that side sometimes. And then it would become obvious that the district court also didn't really take a look at that. And then a focus letter would come out, and once in a while, a vacature order would come down because there was a lack of jurisdiction.
Well, were you in court, were you in my chambers when we got reversed on that mem dispo from the Supreme Court?
If I was in your chambers.
No, here, the mem dispo was written, we followed Ninth Circuit precedent, which it had to do where the center of business was in for rental cars. And so we had to decide it the way that we decided it. However, the Supreme Court took it on, it was just a mem dispo, and took it and said we were wrong. And
That was the Hertz case.
Yes, the Hertz case.
And that was with Judge Ikuda on the panel, too.
But we were wrong because the Ninth Circuit precedent was wrong, but the Supreme Court straightened it out. So we weren't really wrong. We were following
right.
We
were you were bound by that precedent. What was it, nerve center? Nerve center rule?
Yes, right. Exactly.
Okay, well, moving on from jurisdiction, 28J letters. This is an area that I think provides a great deal of indigestion for circuit judges, for law clerks, and for advocates. It seems that there isn't a great deal of direction when it comes to 28J letters. When is it appropriate to file a 28J letter, and when isn't it? Can you speak briefly about 28J letters and the role that it might play in your chambers, and what is a good 28J letter?
Well, I definitely don't like the letters that say, oh, I just found this 1928 case that changes the whole complexion.
We had an 1880 case that was cited in a 28J letter recently. Yeah.
And also, of course, we are aware of new Supreme Court decisions and new Ninth Circuit en banc decisions, but I don't have a problem with advocates calling them to my attention and giving me their spin. That's fine. What's helpful, though, is if there's been developments in, like if a state court case is significant to the decision and there have been developments in state court law, because we don't follow that as closely. Sometimes if there's been a decision on the same issue in another circuit, we take that very seriously. We probably have seen it, but maybe not if it's very recent. So those sorts of 28J letters are actually very helpful.
I think the other thing is don't make them an argument. A lot of people use it as an opera. You need to be judicious about this. You know, don't go
Good
wild
point.
With it. And don't do it like a supplemental briefing. And essentially, if it's a case you missed in the first place, you're really falling on your sword that you should have gotten it in the first place if it was that important. But sometimes if people try to make it supplemental briefing, then the other side wants to respond, and it just turns into a whole nightmare. So you have to be careful, I think Judge Ikuda said, when it's good.
Judge Faber, were you surprised by the flurry of 28J letters you get, like the week ahead of oral argument?
Well, I don't get very many of them, but I don't think they're to be favored, believe me, unless it's some, you know, a new case has just come down or something like that. I mean, you want to know about it, and you'd want a letter on it if your clerks didn't find it or you didn't find it. But I forgot, and here's a case I should have included and forgot about. That's not going to help you much.
You were just speaking about state law, Judge Okuda, and one thing that I think is an area that you see more and more of is the certification of questions of state law to the highest state court. Not to say that state court has to answer the question. They could, within their discretion, answer the question or not. I know the California Supreme Court, more often than not, last I looked, does not answer the question. Not sure why. They didn't really give the reason. The Ninth Circuit certifies and that's it. But how can an advocate best persuade you that an issue should be certified to a state court? I'll tell you why I'm asking the question. More often than not, I see that the judges on the panel are almost sua sponte certifying the question, not because the advocate has asked them to, but because they have decided that is in fact the appropriate course. So if any of you could speak to the certification question, and what's the best way to do it?
Well, I think I know a lot about this because I was a state court judge, and I've fairly successfully, I think every time that I've written a certification order, I've gotten them to accept it. And I thought it was because I knew all the justices and they knew that I wouldn't bother them unless it was really important. But you have to, it's got to be some critical, unresolved issue of state law, and the issue must be of such importance as to justify the involvement of another court and the delay that will be inherent to the certification, because it does delay it, and you really have to convince the court, if you don't weigh in, then we're going to, you know, we're going for it, and we're going to make a mess of it. So, but really, I did other states in, like, Nevada, Washington, the state of Washington, Montana, I think most of them, if the Ninth Circuit asks them to take an issue, they will take it. California has been a little more chary about making those decisions. But the Chief Justice, Tani Cantil Sakauwe, recently spoke to the Ninth Circuit, and she said that they are much more regularly granting certification now, and several of the justices have quite an interest in, if it is an important issue of state law, that they want to weigh in, maybe because we get it wrong a lot of the time, but some of these issues will evade the state courts, and then the federal courts are deciding them one at a time. And so we really, what we do is not binding still on the state courts, but it just is binding on that particular case. So I see it a lot in employment cases, or I think it's good to recognize that, but there will be a delay, and the certification order needs to be really written well. But the California Supreme Court is going to be, I think, will be granting more of them and is granting more.
We wrote a certification letter on a habeas issue 8 years ago, and the California Supreme Court turned us down. And the same issue came up, it's come up repeatedly, and I said, there's been a big changeover now in the California Supreme Court. Let's try again. So we drafted a very whiny, groveling, oh, it's so hard, we don't know what you think. There's been 33 cases on this issue, and they finally took it. So I think there is a change now, which is helpful.
That's some good insights. Before I get to oral argument, I'd like to talk about brief writing. I still happen to think brief writing is the most important part of appellate advocacy. Maybe we can start with some pet peeves. I always like to hear from the judges and their pet peeves. I remember when I asked this question once of Judge Graber, she said, no one knows how to use the word only. It's never used correctly. And she's like, you know, and I got to tell you, ever since she said that, every hour I see it misused, you know, and I try not to misuse it. But I think as practitioners, we learn so much in learning about your pet peeves, writing style, what you like to see, what you don't like to see. Another example is Judge Trott, I remember when I first started clerking for Judge Callahan, he said, I stop reading after 25 pages. Anything after 25 pages, brief or otherwise, we're done. So certainly helps to, I think, evolve our own practices. If you could each share a little bit about your pet peeves, maybe we can start with Judge Faber in terms of brief writing.
Well, I have one that I'm sure a lot of judges would disagree with. My crotchet is I don't like to see Latin phrases in briefs. I think it's presumptuous to say arguendo and a fortiori and things like that. I think our language is English, and I don't like to see Latin phrases in briefs. That's just a personal crotchet.
And spell check doesn't understand it either.
And I like crisp, clear, short, to the point, because I have a short attention span, and lawyers who use too much verbiage and the briefs are too long, you're not going to make your point, even if you think you have to cover every little thing. I think a short, crisp, to the point brief that goes to the heart of the case is what catches a judge's attention and is effective.
Judge Callahan?
Well, I asked my law clerks about this too, because one of the things that you need to understand is the law clerks are reading all of these briefs along with us. And I have early meetings with the law clerks, and they have some, so you really don't want to antagonize them either. And so some of the things that they pointed out was disrespecting the lower court and the opposing party, a failure to define and follow the applicable standard of review. I agree with that. One of my law clerks presently who's in this room is kind of a font geek, and he mentioned several things along those lines. Times New Roman, one clerk said, and he said something about the new Windows update. It's a problem for the SCOTUS briefs. He likes Miller text. When the PDF is in Adobe, purchase open type fonts. And so he said that
Century Family.
Yes.
Font.
So he
That's
said actually that he's so good, he's a font sleuth, that he's actually can tell when our mem dispos, if a procurium is published, he knows who did it by whether they used WordPerfect or Windows or how those things do it. Now, you may not know that because you don't know what judges use what, but that there's that. Citations, when you cite and the site doesn't make any sense, and then we have to read an entire record to try to find what you're talking about and say that it doesn't make anything. If it's statutory or regulatory interpretation, quote the actual statute or regulation. Don't truncate it. Don't cherry pick it, because that's what we have to analyze. I find myself that red briefs tend to be better than blue briefs. And I think that there's a reason for that, because the red won, all right? And so the red doesn't have as much to hide. But from my perspective, the red briefs and the blue briefs should be equally enlightening. And the facts and the procedural history should be the same in both, and that I have everything that I want. And what you will find is if the blue brief is really trying to hide everything, or they don't want to say what the facts are that you need to decide the case, many of us, and I would include myself, then I jump to the red brief because the blue brief is just got all these holes. I can't tell what's happening. If you really want your brief taken seriously, then you need to have all of those things included in it. And then when you get to the argument section, that's when you do it. But don't make your arguments by leaving out facts or leaving out important procedural history. So those are some of the things that I think the statement of the case and the procedural history serve different purposes, whether they're combined or separate. The statement of the case is basically a recitation of the factual basis for the conflict. The procedural history informs the appellate court of what other courts have done. So with dates, you don't have to kill us with dates, but unless they're important. But sometimes a really old date might be important for other reasons. So I think the best conclusions are a sentence explanation for why you should prevail on the issue that you raised. So those are some of the things. I think the PFRs, don't file them and just regurgitate the same thing. You've got to point out something, an important factual error in the opinion, or that or cite something that's contrary to the case law that we considered. Otherwise, you're just trying to spit out the same thing, and we recognize that. We can tell whether it's boots or tennis shoes.
Just a little translation for mostly state appellate practitioners. Red brief is appellee's brief. We don't have a red brief in the state appeals court. And PFR is petition for panel rehearing, as opposed to petition for rehearing en banc. What about the use of the term, this honorable court? I know if in Louisiana, you've got to use that term. It's part of the rules. But seeing it here.
It wouldn't count against you.
It wouldn't count against you. How about
you said this honorable court is stupid and wrong.
Right.
that doesn't work that well.
It doesn't.
It's not that sincere.
Right. Contractions. We're seeing more and more contractions enter into our legal lexicon.
Judge Kosinski, he started the trend.
He started that. Yeah. Well, in large parts, I think he did in the Ninth Circuit. You started to see it in his decisions. But I still think decisions are different from appellate briefs, from as advocates, what we produce to you. Do you feel that it's a little, what is the word, maybe presumptuous or a little, conceited almost, to use contractions? Or maybe there's a better word for it.
I have to say that those sorts of details and like fonts, I don't have any font sleuths on my staff, really don't make that much of a difference in the decision-making process. My advice for brief writers are to think of yourself more as a teacher than as an advocate. I think the best briefs are the ones that take the reader by the hand, and lay it out in a very clear and almost impartial way. Here are the facts, and here is the applicable law. And as you can clearly see, this is how the law applies to the facts. And you go, oh yeah, that's right. And you're convinced, at least until you read the opposing counsel's brief. The one common mistake I see is that the advocates who have been in the trenches for so long know their case and every fact inside and out, and somehow we're invited into the middle of the story. And it's like, but what's going on? I don't know what this refers to, and I don't know about this. You're telling a story. Start at the beginning. You're teaching people who don't really know anything about your story. The other thing that my clerks do come to me with at least once every year, they come running in and they say, can we sanction this counsel? They have these record excerpts and they're not the correct sites and I can't find anything. And where then I like to say, no, we actually can't. You just have to go read the whole record. But if you want the law clerks on your side, when you cite the record, make the cites correct, and make the cites actually say what you say they're saying in the brief. Same with the cases. If you misrepresent the cases and you lose our confidence, then we don't believe anything you're telling us, which detracts from the teacher aspect of it. And then the third thing I'd say, which is you'll hear a lot of pet peeves from everyone, including me, but the problem is that everyone has different pet peeves. And I remember my clerks coming back from their clerkship orientation and told me, well, Judge Graber said, don't put any dates in the bench memos. And I was like, no, chronology is power. I want to know the chronology. So you have to use your best judgment if the story requires dates and laying out things chronologically. Use the dates. Don't worry about Judge Graber. Well, you can worry about Judge Graber.
How does the introduction differ from the summary of argument? You were just talking about telling the story in the introduction. I often find that the summary of argument and introduction just kind of bleed together. They just locate it in different parts of the same brief. Shouldn't they be different in quality and in message? Can you speak maybe a bit about that?
I just have to say I got in trouble. I was on a panel with maybe five or six judges. We were talking to a mixed group of federal public defenders and assistant U.S. attorneys. And I said, don't do an introduction. It's a waste of time. I skip right over it. And every other judge on the panel said, no, we love the introduction. For them, the introduction was the summary of the case. It would be like the brief, the reminder that they would read before they went on the bench. For me, I write my own notes, and I want to skip over and find out. Just tell me what the facts and the law are. I don't need an introduction.
I think the introduction should be just that, how you would like the court to approach the appeal. And I think the summary of the argument tells the reader concisely what you're arguing. I think Judge Acuda is correct. None of these, we're going to do what we have to do to decide the case. And we're going to get to the right answer, regardless of, I don't think people lose appeals because they do terrible work. You just make everyone really angry. because we have to do so much more work. And she's right. I would bet that 3/4 of my law clerks do not believe in the death penalty, but when it comes to sanctioning lawyers, they would give the death penalty. It makes our work so much harder. But it's not that we won't do it. We do.
Let me ask this question of maybe of Judge Faber. Let me start with him. Table of contents. I think it should be a very important, you know, not just visual aid, but also tool of reminding the panel as they're about to go into oral argument quickly what the facts and the arguments are. That ideally is what a table of contents should do. Unfortunately, rarely does it actually accomplish that goal. How do you use table of contents when you're sitting on the circuit, either the Fourth or the Ninth Circuit?
Well, it helps you find things you're looking for. Which can be difficult if you've got a long brief and you want something sticking in your mind, and you want to go back and refresh your mind. I also think a really good table of authorities with complete citations to the cases is extremely helpful when you're at the point where you're to decide the case, because I'll remember things that I want to look up and that are in the brief. And if you have a good table of contents and a good table of authorities, it helps you find them. And there's nothing more frustrating than wanting to consult something and not remembering where it is and not being able to find it.
And you could tell, can't you, when they're written briskly or not reviewed by an attorney, and you can tell that just like a legal assistant has, you know, basically pulled together a table of contents.
Yeah,
a table of
I would suggest that the attorney who's responsible for the brief should make sure that it's edited accurately, and because if it's you get a citation to a case that's off and you can't find it, it's not on the page that it's supposed to be on, you're not going to think very kindly of that lawyer when he's standing before you arguing the case.
When I get a brief from a junior colleague, or when I'm writing a brief for a senior colleague, I will always want to have the table of contents included in that brief, just because I think it's a great way of outlining the argument, whether it's a opening brief, an answering brief, or a reply brief, and it should be kind of like a narrative. It should be able to flow nicely if you were to remove all the elliptical points. And if nothing else, a way of, as I said, bringing the attention back of the panel quickly to what your case is about. Because you are hearing this week alone, Judge, how many cases are you hearing this week?
I think we usually have about, 35 set per a week,
okay.
Something like that, yeah.
So let's talk about appendices to briefs. This is another kind of vexing question. often, I think appendices are attached, or an appendix is attached to a brief. And it's kind of a strange thing. You wonder why it's even there, why it's taking up the paper and the room and the brief. And then other times you wish that there was an appendix to the brief with the right information to be able to assist the panel in its decisional process. Can you speak about your perceived need for an appendix? First of all, is it necessary in certain cases? And what are those cases?
The good thing about an appendix is you think the brief is going on for another 30 pages, and that's the appendix. You go, yay, it's over, conclusion. Normally the thing I look for in the appendix is the local ordinance, you know, something that I can't readily get my hands on. The excerpt from the 1998 guidance manual, which is the bridge between two interpretations of the regulation. So if it's something that I can readily get on the internet or in a law book or on Westlaw, I don't need it in an appendix, but something that's hard to find or hard to get, that's very helpful.
I agree. If it's critical to the appeal and it's not otherwise readily available, that's what otherwise, no. But it is really exciting when you think you have that much more to read and you don't.
maybe we can move on to en banc now, en banc petitions and the en banc process. But before we do, a question that I had was, is there ever a time that you will confer with your panel members about a case in a substantive way before oral argument? For instance, maybe when you're deciding to submit the case on the briefs, is that a time to kind of do a little mini conference over email or something and say, well, I think we all know where we're going here. What kind of collaboration is there before oral argument?
I think one of the things, I do like to submit cases on the briefs if oral argument is not going to be helpful. But if another chambers is writing a bench memo, I would like to see the bench memo. And generally, if someone recommends submission, I will send an email and say something like, well, I think that this case is an affirm for the following reasons, but if either of my colleagues feel differently, I would prefer oral argument. I don't like to be tricked into it. If we basically have circulated a bench memo and we all sort of feel that it's tracking and it wouldn't be helpful, then I'm willing to submit. But if I can, I like to feel out if my colleagues are coming from different places, because then I want to have argument to really delve in deep and see if either I can convince them at oral argument or convince myself that I'm wrong or something along those lines. So we do that some, for me anyway.
What about, yeah, go ahead.
Panels engage in what I call the memo wars. So the bench memo comes out from one chambers and then the other chamber says, well, my law clerk had a different take on this issue, and then you get the counter memo, and then sometimes the first judge writes another memo. So I, when I started on the bench, I did the memo wars, and eventually I realized that was a waste of time, but I'll still, sometimes I do it. And then sometimes you get the bench memo and you say, well, I don't think we have jurisdiction here. And so there will be like a memo exchange about should we ask the advocates to brief us on whether there's jurisdiction, or the parties didn't address this key case that really controls part of their case, should we ask them to brief it? So there is that sort of discussion before oral argument.
But certainly different from the California Court of Appeal, where at least two judges have already agreed.
You have a draft in circulation.
And you have a draft
exactly.
In circulation of the disposition.
The good news about that, though, the way that we are much more sort of less communication before and more after, is I really think that makes oral argument more important when you come in, because for two reasons. California Court of Appeal, you have a right to argument and you decide. It's the opposite in federal court. We decide which cases we want to hear. So if we want to hear from you, that means there's something going on that we want to hear from you. So that's good news for you. You got something to talk about. We also don't have a draft in circulation. So there's a lot more opportunity for you to either mold what the opinion's going to say or move the panel one way or another. And it could be some indication that not everyone's in agreement. So don't minimize oral argument at the federal level.
And maybe now we can move over to rehearing en banc and the process there. My opening questions for you are, how does a brief writer get your attention in a petition for rehearing en banc? And has a petition for rehearing en banc caused you to support en banc rehearing?
Well, I think Judge Ikuda and I get wild over certain things sometimes, and sometimes even we'll send each other something we've written and say, well, we've written a dissent, look at this. And but I think the petition for rehearing, if someone doesn't care enough to write a petition for rehearing en banc, it makes it really hard for an off-panel judge to feel that they're supported in calling the case. And so if I've been disappointed sometimes when I've seen a case, I think it would be worthy, I plan to do a sua sponte, and then for some reason, the party that lost doesn't even, they don't even do anything about it. They don't even help it along. That disappoints me.
We know sometimes they have just decided that they don't want to bother with the Ninth Circuit. They'd rather go straight to the Supreme Court. So that's okay. I understand.
Well, in 2016, and this is in your handout materials, we have some data. I love charts, so we have a chart here. In 2016, we had 810 petitions for rehearing en banc filed. That's down from exactly 500 petitions just 10 years earlier in 2006. There were 1,310 petitions filed. Of the petitions for rehearing en banc filed in those cases, there were 33 en banc ballots sent to the active service circuit judges. Of those 33 en banc ballots, there were 19 grants of the petitions for rehearing en banc. That's generally in line with about 2%. Roughly 2% of petitions for rehearing en banc will be granted. Do you see a difference between a petition for panel rehearing and a petition for rehearing en banc? And if so, what are the different purposes of those two?
Well, a petition for panel rehearing, I mean, you're just telling the same panel that just heard your case that they made a mistake. So unless there's an actual mistake, like they missed a case, or sometimes a panel will go off and decide a case on a point that wasn't raised and argued by the parties and they get it wrong. But unless there's an actual mistake, there's really no point in just doing a petition for review. Whenever my clerks will look at the petition for rehearing and they say, they're raising the same arguments they raised to the panel. It's like, well, you know, we decided that already. A petition for rehearing en banc is a letter to the other judges on the court saying, this panel was so stupid. Can you look at what they did? And so that's a completely different sort of approach.
But you're not reading all 1,000 petitions for rehearing en banc, are you? I mean, you're reading the ones in your cases, but are you actually reading, or is a member of your staff reading all 1,000 of those? Or are you reading the decisions, the published decisions that come out, and then from there kind of going into the petition for rehearing en banc, kind of reversing into it?
Probably more of the latter, so that you know which cases have been decided, which you think are questionable, and then you'll wait for the petition for rehearing en banc to come, if it does, to see what the argument they're making is. Now, there are some chambers, though, that have their clerks read all petitions for rehearing en banc that come out and advise their judge if action should be taken. So they are read by someone.
Well, and Jimmy, you know, having been in my chambers, we have something that we call slip opinions that come, and they get divided out to all the law clerks, and they have generally weekly meetings where they all talk about the cases that have been decided by the Ninth Circuit, and they have specific instructions that to go if there's something the judge would be interested in to then come and talk to me, and that's how it's a little bit of triage. There's actually a lot more cases I would like to call en banc than I have the ability to call en banc, because there's something, for me, there's something a little bit about my personality. When something's wrong, it's hard to let it lie. But that isn't, every time on a court this big, every time something's wrong or that you don't agree with, you can't call all those cases. You simply don't have the resources. It's a lot of work. So you have to really narrow it to something that's of exceptional importance, and somehow you've decided that you're going to take it on, and it's a lot more work for your chambers, and you've got to decide that it's either going to get enough votes to make it, or even if you don't think you'll get enough votes, that you're going to write a dissental that's just going to pop for the Supreme Court, and you will put that on fire so that they can't look the other direction.
Now, you use that term dissental. Can you explain what that term means, dissental?
Well, Judge Kaczynski started that, I believe, and I think someone said like diarrhea or something. I don't know that they couldn't figure it, but it's a dissent from denial of rehearing en banc. And so when you call a case, you don't get enough votes, then you say, this court made a, the full court made a mistake in not going en banc. This is why. And other judges can sign on to it. And so if you can get enough signatures from other judges, it's a, it's also kind of a signal to the Supreme Court, which judges on the court think that it should have been heard by the full court.
And Justice Kennedy has regularly told us at our meetings that the justices do read the dissents from denial and take them seriously and look at how many people signed on. So they do have an impact on the Supreme Court's decision about whether to grant cert.
In fact, I have another data point for you. Approximately 90% of the time when a circuit judge has dissented or has authored a dissental, will the Supreme Court take the case. So, you know, I know Paul Clement once, in speaking to a group like this that we had convened, said that he loves them because basically you're doing the job of the Solicitor General for him or for her by crafting the cert petition. It's basically a mini cert petition. I have such dissental, one such dissental in my hands. It's a recent one in May 2017, authored by Judge O'Scanlan. This is in the United States v. Washington case. For those of you not familiar, this was the case involving culverts and salmon accumulation and a treaty from back, speaking of 1880, I think back in 1880, between the governor of the Western Territories and the nations of the Indian tribes. And he starts off this dissental with a footnote. And he says, as a judge of this court in senior status, I no longer have the power to vote on calls for rehearing cases en banc, or formally to join a dissent from failure to rehear en banc. Following our court's general orders, however, I may participate in discussions of en banc proceedings. And then when you come back up to the top, where it lists all the judges' names that are joining him in dissental, it says, Judge O'Scanlan, circuit judge with whom Judge Kaczynski, Judge Callahan, Judge Okuda, circuit judges join, and respecting the denial of rehearing en banc. Kind of interesting terminology. You don't see that terminology used. It led me to ask this question. Why are senior judges not actively involved in the en banc process? And is it a circuit-specific rule that could be changed?
I don't think it's
statutory. I know the answer. Oh. I made my law clerks research this because I kind of did know. Well, there's it's both it's statute and circuit rules because 28 U.S.C. 46C limits voting on whether to hear a case en banc to active judges, but the same statutory provision leaves it to the discretion of each circuit to decide whether senior judges may serve on an en banc panel once a majority of active judges has voted to hear the case. So then, and then also the Ninth Circuit Rule 35-3 sets forth the rule that en banc panels may consist only of active judges, except that a senior judge that has served on the panel in the case being reheard en banc may elect to be eligible for the en banc panel. So we could change our circuit rule on that, but we can't change the statute because if, I mean, en banc means the whole court voting or a limited en banc or whatever you have. If senior judges could vote, that would essentially widen the world of who can vote, of how the full court goes en banc. So we can't change the statute, we could change the rule.
And it's fair to say then that a senior circuit judge could call a case
yes.
en banc, could make an en banc call. Let me ask you about the 11 judge panel petit en banc system that we have in the Ninth Circuit. As you know, recently there have been some proposals to split the Ninth Circuit, kind of a dreaded topic, I know, for circuit judges. On the Ninth Circuit. And Judge Faber, I was tempted to ask you what you think about this subject coming from West Virginia. And maybe if there's time at the end, I'd like to get your thoughts on that. But, you know, at one point you moved to a 15-member en banc petit panel, and then have now come back down to 11-member petit en banc panel. I think that's because back then, Congressman Sensenbrenner, I think it was making all these calls to split the Ninth Circuit, and there was a compromise reached that the Ninth Circuit would move up to a 15-judge panel. Do you feel that the 15-judge panel is a good idea? Do you feel that more judges should participate on the en banc panel, or is 11 judges enough? We're seeing that there are a lot of 6-5 splits, you know, that are around, and certainly this might help to dissipate some of the fears of the proponents of a Ninth Circuit split, who feel that there are a lot of outlier decisions in the Ninth Circuit. A lot of material I just put at you, but maybe you can talk about your views about the circuit split and the pros and the cons to moving to a larger en banc panel.
Well, she doesn't want to talk about the circuit split. I'll talk about it a little bit. What I find annoying is that every time that someone on this, some three-judge panel, makes a decision that they don't like, even though we make 14,000 decisions a year or whatever, that's when they decide to split the circuit. I think that I have a problem with that, because a lot of times I don't agree with everything that this court decides. There's a lot of decision making going on, but I don't think you want a system that every time there's something that you don't like. I also, in my view, even though it may, California is the elephant in the room. California is about close to 70% of the caseload of the Ninth Circuit, even though we have 9 states and we go all the way out to Guam. So unless you split California in half, or unless you give California a whole bunch more judges, that you're not going to solve that problem. That's another problem. Some of the proposals, for example, one's California and Hawaii together. Then California would be 96% of the caseload, Hawaii would be 4%. I don't think a circuit should be a super Supreme Court. For California's got a Supreme Court. I don't think a circuit should be that. So if they want to come up with a split, I think that there is something to be said for it should be broader and should include more than just California as far as that goes. We already have California determining what California does. That being said, I think the Ninth Circuit is really quite efficient in the way that they handle things. It's going to cost more money because you're going to have to build more facilities, and they're not going to give us the money to do it. They're probably not going to give us the judgeships to do it. And so, in my view, it's somewhat of a knee-jerk in terms of they don't like a decision, and this is a good way to retaliate. That being said, we actually can have a full en banc. There is a provision for all 29 judges to go full en banc. As a practical matter, there have been calls like that, but it hasn't ended up. I sat on some of the 15. I thought it was a nightmare. It was it was just like a Tom Jones food fight. There were so many people talking on top of each other. It was a nightmare. 11 is not ideal for a lot of reasons, because it's subject to the luck of the draw. So which 11 get drawn, you know, sometimes you look at it and you go, yes, it's a good panel for me. Or, no, this is terrible. I'll be writing a dissent. And so there is, I think, going from 11 to 15 did not work very well as a manageable process. So there isn't, there's not any perfect solution, but I think we're doing okay.
I think the full panoply of circuit judges, the 29, is referred to as en banc en masse. If I'm correct.
But Judge Faber would not allow that. Big on bonk.
More Latin terms than compound Latin terms. You know, there's been some rumor and some news lately that the administration may be contemplating switching seats from one state to another, meaning circuit judge seats from one state to another. What do you think about that?
Like the splitting the Ninth Circuit, I would say that's a political question, and we don't have jurisdiction.
Good. You agree?
Well, if they could get things done, you know, it's just there's a lot. I guess I've been around long enough that I'm a little bit philosophical from the standpoint that I feel that a president has a right, you know, to to nominate and then by the advice and consent of the Senate. And I don't think that the advice and consent is to litmus the people for their own, that you're going to get, you're going to change presidents, and whoever wins is going to be able to appoint more people to their liking, and then it's going to change and it's going to shift back and forth. But I do think that it should be more orderly, it should be more expeditious, and all of these are just fights that when there was the Idaho and the California dispute over whether Judge Trott's seat was Idaho, and so it essentially delayed filling it for, what was it, close to a decade or something like that.
And he,
we need bring in the reinforcement. You know, I'm a tap dancer. We're dancing as fast as we can dance. We want to do more cases. We want to decide your cases as expeditiously as possible. So I would like to see anything that delays the confirmation process and is subject to politicization. While I might be in favor of it in concept, I just don't think it would work, and we would be the victims of it.
Senators are very sensitive about losing ballot seats from their states. We had a situation in West Virginia where an effort was made to remove one of, we had an open appellate seat to switch it over to another state, and Senator Byrd blocked the appointment of a person to fill that seat for like 8 years or something until the national politics switched, and then he got his person in the seat, and West Virginia got to keep the seat. So
the truth be known that there is nothing in the Constitution that requires a lot of the things that go on to go on. It doesn't require the ABA. It doesn't require the blue slips. It doesn't even really require the senatorial courtesy on how that occurs. And there's an argument to be made, if the Ninth Circuit is all of these, how come two senators from a state can block a nomination, and why isn't it all the senators as far as that? And none of that is in the Constitution. It says nominate by the advice and consent of the Senate. So these are all things that have been man-made or woman-made or self-created, and they're not required by the Constitution. So if you really want to go back to the original language, we fight about things that aren't required.
And, you know, in the example you gave about Judge Trott, I remember there was a battle. Was it an Idaho seat? Was it a L.A. or a California seat, rather? And I think he broke up the debate by saying, well, I've looked at my commission, and it says that I was appointed in West Falls, Virginia. Falls Church, Virginia. So if anything, he said it could be a Virginia seat as far as we know. So, are there any questions from the audience for our distinguished panel? Just raise your hand, or have we covered everything? Yes.
I'm happy when the advocates don't call us you guys.
Dave Robinson and I saw that happen in court not too long ago.
When you tell me your name, too, that sometimes people get so nervous that they forget to say what their name is. And we are recording it, and we're trying to give that some sort of semblance. So I kind of like I think it's like going to church, you know, that don't wear flip-flops to church. Don't polish your shoes before you come, because I'll notice. And don't wear a really bad tie. Because if your argument isn't very good, I'm going to be thinking that's the reason why.
And don't read from your hymnal, and don't sing.
Yeah. No props.
Question over here.
James, I think your stat was 2% of petitions for unbound are granted.
Roughly.
I was wondering if there were any, it may be too small a sample size, but if there were any kind of common currents running through those 2%, or any certain way that those petitions tee up the issues that draw attention to that in a way that unsuccessful petitions.
I've seen a lot recently a trend towards what I would say is error correction. So a majority of the judges in the Ninth Circuit would have come out a different way in that particular case. So I think, as opposed to what the Federal Rules of Appellate Procedure says, which is that en banc hearings are for correcting intra-circuit splits or for issues of extraordinary importance, words to that effect. I don't believe it's something that the PFREB did magically, but that some judges on the court were unhappy with how a panel decided a case and brought it to the attention of their colleagues who agreed.
So I think the sky is falling is always good, though. That if a decision is just wrecking havoc is a good thing to point out.
A couple questions that came in online were, have you ever granted rehearing en banc on a panel decision that was a memorandum disposition? And then the second question was, how does it differ in quality from a published opinion?
I don't think we ever have on a mem dispo, have we?
The Supreme Court has granted
cert. The Supreme Court's granted cert.
Right. Dispo, but we've never, to my knowledge, at least not while I've been on the court.
And Hertz was a mem dispo, I think.
Right. But the thing is that we don't have enough time. If a mem dispo, if we don't have to follow it, then we just don't have enough time to call it, I think.
I can't remember a time either. I was racking my head. Any other questions? Okay. Well, I want to thank our distinguished panel members, Judges Faber, Callahan, and Akuta, for joining us today.
Kind of like acknowledging the band, orchestra.
Well, on a personal note, it has been a while since we've had a circuit judge in residence in Orange County with the passing of Judge Ferguson. I believe, actually, Judge Akuta, you might be in his direct lineage. Is that right? Did
no,
you?
I was Browning.
Were you Browning? Okay. So Judge Ferguson was our last circuit court judge in Orange County, and we certainly miss him. We have the Warren Ferguson Inn of Court here. But it, as I was explaining to the judges before we started today, it's really a treat to be able to get our circuit judges to come and visit with all of us. We certainly love to see you, and we hope that you'll send word back home to the mothership that we'd love to see many more of you, too.
Well, you know why we're here. That guy. I can't say no to that guy. And then she can't say no to me. And he couldn't say so at all. Yeah, it's all about asking people that can't say no to you.
Well, Judge Faber, what's your reason?
So
that
on.
Guy, so hot. Point to his law clerk. Well, thank you very much.
And he's his law clerk, and then he's coming to clerk for me. So it's all we can't say no.
Well, thank you very much, everybody.
Thanks, Jimmy.
You know, one of the things they do on the Fourth Circuit, I love this, at oral argument, the judges come down and shake your hand.
Yeah, so it's nice. Some of our judges do that before.
Do they?
So, Judge.